constant elevation. Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to a brand new episode of Simsation Nation. I am extremely excited for our guest today. It is someone that has paved the way for the Simsation Nation podcast as a whole. I have literally followed his blueprint, and to have him on today as a guest is a complete honor for me. In fact, I wore this shirt in his honor because I know for a fact that Hawaii means a great deal to him. So I actually went in my closet. I'm a fashionista, so I had to go in there and find something that was going to be suitable for this particular moment. Before I get him on to kind of talk a little bit about his background, I want to make sure I get a good plug in for his book. He is the author of this book called No Pressure, But Don't Mess This Up. I have read it probably twice. Now, it is a book about leading a squadron, which is a military organization, but I think that it is suitable to be something that you can learn from leading any organization. He is also the founder, the absolute monster on the Constant Elevation podcast. So I highly recommend that you all go out there and take a look at that. Take a listen, take a look, whatever you decide to do, but please go out there and follow Constant Elevation and pick up this book, No Pressure. So without further ado, let me welcome Gabe Avila to the show. Sir, thanks for coming on.
Yo, thanks. Sure, man. That was a very, I'll give you some money later, at least 60 bucks for that intro. That was unnecessary, but nah, I'm excited. This is a, we've had some previous discussions as far as, you know, congratulations on your platforms and everything that you're doing. I think it's a, it kind of can be intimidating a little bit in the beginning. Then we just go, like, it keeps on going. It keeps on constantly elevating. You know what I'm saying? Right. And so, but nah, I'm happy to be here. And, yeah, congratulations.
No, I thank you, and I certainly appreciate that. So if you could just give us a quick rundown of what made you decide to write this book and just kind of give us the premise of the book itself.
Sure. So when I was at the end of my second squadron command tour up in Alaska, and I had a large amount of I spent a lot of time just kind of thinking, meditating, writing down some notes, and a lot of times getting asked for advice. And so kind of out of not pure laziness, but more efficiency, I was like, I'm going to write stuff down. That way, when people ask me the same questions, I could be like, here's the thing. And so I started actually writing it as a little blog post. I used to have a blog called Project Rise, and then I would share them. And then eventually I just kind of challenged myself. I was like, you know what? I'm going to try and write a book. I want to figure out a method to actually compile all of my thoughts, because I really wanted to give some kind of perspective on leadership. And then eventually I hooked up with my wife's high school classmate. She's a professional book editor. So she helped me. Shout out to Kelly Leidick. She gave me some advice on how to kind of tell a proper story. And so something that's, you know, obviously relevant to me is the story of Squadron Command. And so that was kind of the theme. And I'm like, all right, cool. Let me just think about the arc of a Squadron Command tour, and then kind of talk about some leadership things that I did go through, and also would give advice maybe to someone who's about to step into the seat or something like that. And so it talks about the arc of a 24-month, typical 24-month squadron command tour, and just my perspective. And I also believe the other reason why I wrote it is because there isn't many books like that out. There are official Air Force, Air University products. And I actually thought about going through that route to get it published with them. I was like, nah, fam, I'll just do it myself.
Right.
Because I just wanted it to be me. And I think it's we have a kind of a changing of a guard, I believe, in some of the leadership levels within the Air Force and actually just in general society that it's okay to be yourself, the authentic self as a leader in your organization. I agree with you that like some of the, I wrote it, although I have to think about, you have to have a central theme. And so write what you know about. So I know about military organizations, but the things that I talk about in the book are applicable to any organization, because if you're going to be, you know, you're a rising leader, a brand new CGO or a coming to grade officer or junior enlisted or junior, you know, person joining an organization, you should be thinking about like, if you want to escalate in the ladder, what kind of mindset you should have as you gain additional responsibilities. And so I try to write it as far as depending on where you're at in your journey, you actually can still get benefit from it. And then maybe look back at it. If you happen to read it more than once, the second time you read it, you'll be like, oh yeah, you maybe through your career experiences, you've actually experienced something, and that hopefully there's some nuggets of knowledge in there that shine a little bit brighter based on what you need at the time.
Yeah. You know, I love the fact that this book is an easy read to me. Partly because I can relate to it, you know, obviously following the same path that you're on right now. It was something that was easily something I can relate to. But it's an easy read as well. And I think it's something that can be very applicable just to someone that's not affiliated with the military. And one thing that I do admire about this book and you for two is that I know what I'm going to get, right? And there's no better leader than being someone who's authentic, right? You need to have authentic leadership in every organization that you have. So with someone like yourself, who has a very large social media presence, in that book, you talk a little bit about the effective use of social media. I used to have a rule where, hey, look, I'm not going to friend you on social media until I leave this job kind of thing. And then eventually I found that that wasn't always feasible because it was a direct connect. So what are your thoughts on leaders in an organization using social media to their advantage or the negatives of using it?
I think social media ends up becoming just it's the most common strategic communication platform you have, right? And so you can use it for good or bad, like anything else. I choose to take advantage of it. And I kind of have like a couple things in my head. I'm like, all right, well, whatever I'm doing, it's super, super simple. And I think most people should do this. Whatever you do on social media, you better be okay with your mom reading it.
Right.
That's gotta, if you're not doing that, then, and I stand by everything that I put on my own platform or any kind of content that I create, like that it's a weird kind of thing. But like, if my mom and dad saw it, I want them to not be, they may be like, you could tone down the language, be like, ah, all right, mom, that's fine. But the idea that the thoughts that I have and kind of the principles I want to talk about, that's what I choose to do. And so a large amount of social media, I focus on my family, you know, I talk about, and I kind of overshare a little bit. If you work with me, you know, if you're one of the athletes I coach, I overshare. Like I just talked about my daughter returning home for college, talk about that whole path. Us trying to take some, my wifey and I trying to take some leave over in a Shenandoah in March. And so like, that's just me. Yeah. Every single platform, whether it's social media, in-person, podcast platform, it should be you, right? Okay. And to a fault, you're going to have to be comfortable with that. You know, even when I'm at work, you know, if I'm talking to the boss and I talk into COMAC or whatever it is, a higher ranking general, it sounds exactly like this. I just add a sir, ma'am at the beginning end. No. There is no difference, again, for good or bad. And my career has had, we'll call it, I won't say ups and downs, but it's been affected by my choices. But in the end, when I go home and look at myself in the mirror, I feel comfortable. They're like, nah, man, I'm staying true to Gabe Rock. I know who I am as a leader. And I'm going to take the goods and bads as we keep on moving forward.
And as you walk in, everyone knows what they're going to get. And it doesn't have to be hot, warm, cold on any given day. It's, you know what you're going to get. Personally, just hearing what you just said, I think social media humanizes you. It allows the folks that you may be leading to see, well, he's actually, or she's actually a human being. They're normal people and they're great leaders. You know, there's no better way to get people to want to claim you as their leader. And you talked about that in your book.
Another piece of advice I would say is don't try and do the curated kind of method. Don't just a better leader, I'll say, will understand the power of social media, and it's okay to talk about your failures. It's okay to reveal if you have some vulnerabilities and how you're dealing with it and asking for help. I do that all the time. Part of my podcast is kind of cathartic for me anyway, because I'm kind of talking through my thoughts and getting my emotions out there, and then people reach out and then we talk about some solutions and I'm like, all right, cool. That's what it's for. I think that's the difference kind of as well, is the next rising generation of leaders is like, it's okay. You don't have to be like this, like a stonewall type of person where you're nope, nothing affects me and I'm going to take the hill. And I was like, no, nobody's like that anymore. Or you can be like that. I just think it's not sustainable. And when I can have a good harmony of my, in my life, that's what I'm trying to look for. And hopefully I can, if just leadership by example, that people see me be like, where I get frustrated, I'm frustrated. And I'm mad or whatever it is, but I still try and maintain to my values. I still try and stay on the high road because I'm understanding the responsibilities that I have in the position that I have. And I want to make sure that I don't waste that.
Absolutely. No one could be a better you than you. You know, we have similarities throughout the world, but there is only one of us. You talked a little bit a second ago about your wife, you and your wife taking leave. I would imagine, you know, the higher up you get into your organization, leadership position, civilian or military, whatever it may be, your demand is a lot more than what it used to be. People want your decision. They want to reach out to you. How have you managed? I know you mentioned that in your book a little bit. How have you managed your leave and taking vacation?
I think so. It's kind of, okay. So I try and work out at least I try and work out 5 times a week, but instead it usually goes down to like 4. Lately, especially I'm old, and so like, I can't be working out like that anymore. It's all right, depending on what's going on, but I try and, well, basically what I'm saying is my workout time are mandatory appointments. It's blocked into my schedule, and so I don't have to fight for the time, so I can make sure I work out. I treat leave the same way. And so like the son, our son has spring break in April. And so, nope, that's a mandatory appointment for me. I put it on the block. I let everybody know, like, y'all, we try and obviously amongst your team discuss it, because some people may or may not have spring, they may not have kids in a grade school or high school anymore, and so maybe they're not aware of that spring break. I try and pay attention to those kind of dates and times, just being like, yeah, though these are important dates, I want to try and I pencil them in. So for instance, I know I'm going TDY freaking tomorrow. I'm going to San Antonio. February I'm going to Colorado. So already in March, is like, before anybody says anything to me,
right,
I'm taking a week. I don't care. I'm putting it in there. I forward it to the front office. They're like, tracking, we got it. And so you have to pay yourself, right? Like, we have earned this time off. I know that, like, if I'm going to surge at work because it's needed of me, I know I need that recharge time, and I want to spend that time with my family. Right. A couple times I'll take a day or so, just go do my own thing, go to the comic book store or whatever it is. And that those are good days as well. But also understanding that this is an opportunity for your team to lead without you. That's right. It's very important to be like, yo, deputies, don't screw this up. Branch chiefs, make sure you turn in your stuff on time, because I already told, I, so before I left, I set like a bunch of stuff out. Like, here's everything that needs to happen when I'm gone. Mm-hmm. Just take care of it. Right. And so it's a leadership challenge. Right. And I'm okay with, I don't have to be in front of them with sure. the boss as every single time. And sometimes depending on the moment, I'll go talk to my supervisor and be like, hey, so this meeting is going to be rough. I need you to just be cool with it, because there is a larger thing I'm trying to do. So there, because it could be maybe the first time for like a junior officer, junior enlisted to talk to a senior officer. And it can be very, very nervous. I'm not going to lie. I sometimes get nervous too, depending on the subject matter. But right. like, if you give them that room for error, kind of like, not like big failure, but like lowercase, like, there were some bumps in there, but they know it's safe. Then it's like, oh, the pressure's kind of lifted off, and they can actually, be comfortable with themselves, and then the work just gets better from that. And so, but sure. if I'm not there, then they never get that opportunity.
No, that's perfect. You know, recharging your batteries is really important. So taking and being on leave is extremely important. As they say, you cannot pour from an empty cup. So, you know, in order to make yourself successful in the future, you've got to take care of yourself so you can take care of others. And at the same time, I used to always tell people, you know, if the organization is running smoothly while I'm here, that's okay. But the real test is how well the organization is running when I'm not.
Exactly. Exactly.
So love talking about your book, but I want to transition now into the topic that I asked you to come on to discuss with us. In particular, throughout my career, I've heard two different aspects of this analogy. And it in turn talks about success and how you achieve success. I've heard on one side, hey, keep doing what you are doing. Don't change, because it's gotten you this far. But I've also heard, hey, what got you here won't get you there. So you're going to have to make some adjustments if you really want to continue throughout this career. What are your thoughts on those two comparative analysis, on that comparative analysis? And do you have a preference over the other?
I think like most COA decision briefs, which is the one that course of action decision briefs, which one you're going to pick? The hybrid one.
Right.
That's the answer. The answer is both of those kind of, but I think it's important to understand how they could both be used complementary to each other versus you should pick one over the other. So I'll talk about the, what got you here won't necessarily get you there. So I had that same advice given to me by my mentor when I was a captain, and I was a lieutenant. I think it was a lieutenant going to a captain or captain going to a major, just it's a promotion. And so I believe the power of that kind of phrase is understanding your perspective in the world, assuming you get additional responsibilities. They have to shift a little bit, because the way, especially in a military organization where you have recognized ranks, depending when you're moving around in organizations, the first thing they see is, oh, you're a major, you're a master sergeant. Like, and automatically there's a certain level of expectation of performance that's expected for the enlisted force. You kind of have the little brown book that kind of tells you that, but it's for the officers. And especially for me, like, no, I get it. You're a lieutenant. You barely know anything. That's okay. But I expect you to have a little bit of responsibility and know how to do organizational stuff. And then as you progress, I expect that level of your functional, your trade for you to be an expert in that.
Nice.
And so that idea of understanding, I would say the more you keep on going higher up in an organization, the more you need to understand your lateral relationships. Sure. Basically, like, you can't just be a lot of times I think in our OCPs. So you have your functional badge, right? On your uniform, it talks about this is what your trade is. So for you and I, we're communications officers. Sure. So that's good. We have to understand that that's our trade. We should be really good at that. But as you progress in rank, what's going to happen is you're going to start understanding how everybody's dependent on comm for real. That's so right. the 100% fax machine, there needs to be, you need to understand as well, your contribution to the maintenance mission, to the logistics readiness squadron, to the operators. I mean, like, those kind of pieces, as you continue to go up in organization, if you want to keep on going up to get there, you need to understand how you're contributing to there and be a dependable teammate, be accountable teammate. Those kind of pieces, I believe, are important. Just because if you just stay in your foxhole and only do that and just kind of ignore whatever else is going on about you, you're never going to get there because you don't understand the Air Force. So when I talked about the uniform, your functional badge is above on the top of your uniform. And then when you go lower, that badge says US Air Force. Mm-hmm. That's the team you're on. You need to understand you are part of a larger team. So if you want to continue to make progression in your career and have higher responsibilities, you better keep your eye on the ball in that bigger team.
Right. That's right. That's awesome. That is a great way to look at it. And to be quite frank, I didn't think about, you know, taking bits and pieces of both of those and just kind of making it, you know, the best that works for you. You know, leadership, followership, success, all of that is really an art and not a science. And you've got to figure out what works best for you.
I think that getting also, when you're trying to get there, you have to start thinking your mindset. You know, it's the thing of, you should think about what your boss's boss is thinking about.
Yeah.
Usually thinking about and being not predictable, but kind of forecasting what your boss's boss is going to think of. That way your deliverables, your focus ends up becoming meeting what before your boss has to ask you for anything. You already know what needs to happen. It also becomes a formality. Like, I'm giving you an IPR, but basically it's just a checkpoint because I'm gonna keep on doing it because I already know this is what needs to happen.
That's right.
And so that idea of understanding how to keep on constantly elevating, again. If you want to keep on constantly elevating, there's some pieces of just understanding where you're at in your career. And you don't have to go too far. If you're a captain, don't try and act like a colonel. Don't do that. Be a captain, be a really good captain and start acting like a major, those kind of pieces. Like, there is a, you know, don't act too big for your britches. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is understanding what is that next step, that right next thing, and then start getting some practice reps, find those opportunities to develop your leadership style and just add more tools to your toolkit. That's going to be, that'll help you, I believe, get to the places where you want to be.
Nice. Speaking of constant elevation, as we approach our end here, sadly, as I watch your episodes on constant elevation, as I read through your books, one thing that I have learned is that you do things in threes. So as we get close to ending the Simsation Nation podcast, what are three things, three pieces of advice, three things, whatever comes to your mind? I like to do things impromptu. Someone wanted to continually and constantly elevate. What are three pieces of advice that you will leave them with?
Okay. So I'm going to go back to, you said there was two things I was supposed to talk about, right? One, what got you here won't necessarily get you there. I already talked about that. Mm-hmm. Then you started talking about stay true to yourself. So my first piece is stay true to yourself. You have to be an authentic leader. How I do that is understanding my core principles. If you go look at constant elevation, you do a search for alphabet aerobics, you'll see my leadership philosophy that I have in there. And those are the things that I've been consistently, it doesn't matter what rank I have. It doesn't even matter if I'm in the office or I'm in the gym or I'm in my house. Those are my core principles that I try and actually emulate all the time. So understand your compass, understand your purpose. That's going to be that first thing I would believe I'd share. And don't be afraid to update it. That's obviously, I just remixed my leadership philosophy as I achieved my next rank. And so those kind of pieces, I think, will help you as a leader. Number two would be, and this is hard, stay on the high road as much as possible. Mm. because it's going to be, you're going to encounter certain challenges, certain kind of interactions with the people, and your ego is going to want to do something weird. It's going to want to be like, I'm about to say something just to prove a point and just make them feel bad. And I just want to be right. I don't care if I'm going to be angry or put someone's down. That's behavior is highly negative and really toxic for not only for yourself, but the team at large.
Right.
So second item would be, as much as possible, stay in the high road. I'm trying, when I lead my divisions and I try to tell everybody like, hey, so I don't care what everybody else is doing. Our team in A6O is staying on the high ground. And I need you to be okay with that. I'm going to give you top cover as much as possible to make sure that there is enough runway for you to make sure you can do what you need to do, but you better stay professional because that's what I expect out of it. Mm-hmm. And the last piece I'll say is what you're going to focus on, what your priorities are, make sure you give your full effort. Don't give half effort. Nobody cares about half effort. If you do half effort over 30 things, just half effort. I'd rather you do full effort on like 10 things, whatever that is. So what that means is you have to make those mental decisions. You have to talk it over with your leadership, talk it over your team. What are the true things that I'm going to really, we as a team or me personally have to really deliver on and give full effort to that. Don't get half effort. Half effort might as well just be no effort because you're just wasting time. Right. Full effort. So in summary, yes, I do things in threes. It would be one.
Let me make sure I'm learning from you. So number one, be true to yourself. Mm-hmm. Number two, always take the high road. Mm-hmm. And number three, whatever it is that you're doing, put full effort towards it. Did I get it?
That's right. Bam, see, look at that.
I'm getting mentorship over here. Hey, listen, as we wrap up, I want to ask, what is the best way for the audience to go out there and purchase this book called No Pressure, But Don't Mess This Up?
Sure. So you can go to my website, constantelevation.co. And so you can find it there. You can also, you can go to Amazon and Barnes and Noble. There's both the soft copy and the ebook Kindle version. If you prefer that to read your books. A lot of times if I'm TDY, I'll bring some. And so if you're like, if I'm at a conference and then you walk by me and you hit me with a can't stop, won't stop, I'll be like, yo, then I'm walking back. And then all of a sudden I got an autographed copy for you. And so it's always kind of nice if people, and I also highly recommend it to other rising leaders, be like, maybe you're not going to Squad Command, but hey, so pass it on. I'm totally, you don't have to buy separate things, just pass it on. And if that knowledge helps that person along their journey, I'll be forever grateful. It's my method of trying to pay it forward for the, I have a lot less runway in front of me than I have behind me in the Air Force. So I'm trying to leave some good things because I want to be proud of the Air Force that I have shaped and where the Air Force heads in the future.
Nice. And last but not least, if folks wanted to get more mentorship from you, they wanted to go out there and watch the videos, make contact with you, ask you questions, what are the best ways to do that? Any media platforms that they can find you on?
Sure. Yep. And so I'll give you some of the links and you can put them in the show notes. And so I have a YouTube channel. If you search for Gabe Rockavilla, it's going to be out there, at Constant Elevation. And then if you, again, you go to constantelevation.co, you'll find my contact info. I'm all on the social platforms. You can DM me and I get a lot. People ask me things all the time and I use those. I kind of put them in order depending on when I get inspired or something is happening or I don't necessarily have to put it out there. If you want to have a one-on-one kind of mentorship discussion, I've had lots of these very much like this similar kind of Zoom discussion. Mm-hmm. And my time is your time. So anybody who needs to reach out, please do.
Ladies and gentlemen, you heard it here first. I enjoyed this time and I hope that you all did with the coolest colonel in the United States afterwards. No pressure, but don't mess this up. Until next time, we appreciate you guys for dialing us on Simsation Nation. I'm out.
Peace.